My name is Robert Joseph Stark. I'm here in Anchor Point, Alaska on the Kenai Peninsula, kind of the southwestern side, 20 miles outside of Homer, Alaska, just south of Nanilchik. I have 20 acres of land here that I purchased in May of 2012, and it came with a beautiful cabin you'll see soon. It's all off the grid, and yeah, we're just trying to turn it into a farm. Slowly but surely, and you'll see there's a lot of jobs that haven't been completed because either one, I'm a little lazy or procrastinate in certain areas, or two, I don't have the skill yet and I don't want to pay people. So we're trying to do things as cheap as possible while also not, you know, make the quality poor. Here we'll start with all this here was some trees and stumps and this brush that was overgrown. And when I first bought it, it was coming through with the weed whacker, chainsaw, shovel, digging up as many stumps, roots, fireweed, little trees, birch trees that we could, and doing our best to clear it out. And I only got so far until finally my neighbor, who had traded a Rottweiler puppy for time with the excavator, drove over in the excavator and he plowed it for us. And he made that berm over there on the eastern side of the property. And yeah, really made it what it is. If it wasn't for that guy, we couldn't have it. So it turned into our vegetable garden this year. We planted perennial fruit trees, apples on the outside, the south side over here, different varieties, a Red Harrelson variety, and Wolf River from Wisconsin and Minnesota. I bought all the trees that you see here from one orchard down in Onalaska, Washington. When I was going to college before Evergreen for sustainable agriculture, we toured this guy's farm. And he just had the most beautiful edible forest with hazelnuts down to apples and cherries to strawberries and canes. I mean, everything you saw pretty much you could eat. And I really trusted him. He said these are all really hardy varieties. Yeah, we do all of our ordering from him. So last year was our experimental year where we planted 12 apple trees, 4 pear trees, and then all of our rhubarb and raspberries and strawberries that you'll see. Yeah, they all made it through the winter. We had one pear and one apple that we thought got eaten to death by the moose because we didn't have a fence up. They're coming back, so I think they're all gonna be good. This year we bought 40 apples and expanded with the hazelnuts and all kinds of stuff. Sorry, I'm a litter bug. Then here we have the vegetable garden. We weren't planning to do this many vegetables this year. We were just gonna work on the fruits, but we had the space, so we figured why not. Under here, we have our beets. You know, this here is a rime. It's a fabric woven cloth that is used to trap moisture, heat, and humidity in the garden beds. I've seen the difference. I haven't used it before on my own growing. I did when I worked on farms in Washington, but I wanted to keep it natural and not have that look. But man, I swear by it now. The difference in my beets here that you see, you know, these little guys, which of course they're still not as nice as some that people have, but they're growing. Then you'll see on this other bed over here, we have beets that we planted 10 days before and they're not even half the size. This rime really works. So we got the rime on most of our beds. Here's the beets, cabbage, got Brussels sprouts. And then behind the Brussels sprouts, those are carrots, which we've had a little spottiness with the carrots, but they're gonna be all right. And then we got 2 rows of potatoes. We grew these potatoes last year, and then we saved the seeds, and it was our first time saving the seeds and replanting them. And I was a little worried about how they were gonna do, but they're doing great. We got 3 different varieties, red, purple, and white. And we'll use these to eat for the winter, you know, and save some for next season and give some out, maybe sell a little bit to a brewery. They'll buy them. So yeah, and then over here we got radishes. We just did a big harvest of them yesterday that we sold to some people in Seward as well as this restaurant. And then see, these are the tiny beets. See these guys?
Oh, they're so small.
I mean, horsetail, get out of here. They're nothing compared to the ones under the rime.
Wow.
You know, really. And I think it may also be because they're close to the radishes, but it shouldn't be that big of a detriment to their health, honest to God. So, and then we got the peas on the background growing up. They're looking all right. Hopefully here in the next couple weeks, we'll start getting some peas. Kind of consider ourselves fall farmers this year because we're really not harvesting much right now. You know, some radishes and chives and things, but hopefully come fall, we'll be doing pretty good. Yeah, I would love to do farmers markets. And one of the main things I've seen and noticed with the farmers markets, I go every week. Not only the one in Homer, but other places, I've noticed that a lot of times people, they put these high tunnels in and they're beautiful. They're producing amazing stuff, but they're all grown vegetables. So I really don't want to specialize in vegetables. That's why I'm trying to grow fruit. That's why I'm doing the apples and the raspberries and the strawberries with intentions that in the future they will produce and I can be the guy down there slinging fruit, you know, because you can make some good money on fruit, man. Well, last year we had probably in all of our berry plants, like 4 strawberries. This is their first season and they were all eaten by chickens. So last year we had chickens, right? And they were producing eggs and we were selling the eggs and it was a beautiful thing. But I didn't really know that they were gonna come through. I mean, I was all happy. Oh God, they're eating all the bugs. This is amazing. Yeah, until they devastated our rhubarb and our strawberries and the raspberries. I mean, our rhubarb was down to the crown. Our strawberries were, they were eating the leaves, everything, you know? So finally we fenced off the best we could, the rhubarb bed over there, and they grew back. Not to the point where they are now, which they've been harvested multiple times, so they were bigger, but they were just devastated. And we were just happy that they came back by fall and made it through the winter. And this season, we don't have chickens because things happen in the fall time. Had to leave the Seward. Mother got sick. Ended up the neighbors were taking care of the chickens. Naturally, the chickens started migrating towards food, the other neighbors' houses. And so to this day, there's 2 of those birds that made it. We had 16. I was told a lot of the neighbor dogs were, you know, roving over when my dogs were gone. And yeah, so we don't want to get chickens just yet again because we don't know what we're going to be doing in the winter and everything. And that's another reason we're really trying to do the perennial farm, is so we don't have to be here every summer all the time watering our garden and this and that. Once these fruits start establishing themselves and start producing, it's going to be go time, and I think it's going to be pretty easy to maintain them. Yeah, well, you have annual plants, you know. Your annual plant is like a radish. You plant the seed, and within 1 year, that plant goes through its life cycle, and it produces seeds. So the radish will grow up, and it'll turn into a nice little radish like that. But here, just about right now, it's about 60 days after I planted these. No, 50. They'll start bolting is what it's called. You know, they'll start harnessing all that energy, and boom, shoot it up through the center, and they'll shoot up this stem. And that stem will come up, and then it starts turning real hard. The radish does. You can't really sell that. You know, you don't even want to put it in cans. It doesn't taste good. But then it puts up that stalk, and then it produces seeds. So an annual does that year after year. You know, it's a one year life cycle. Biennial is like a raspberry, where the canes, you know, they live 2 years. First year they produce, I might be wrong on that, but they are biennials. Kale, biennial, and that's where, you know, you plant, like we have kale here. We planted the kale this season. It's going to grow up, which it is now if we uncover the beds, but and then we'll be able to harvest that kale in the winter because next season is when it'll start producing its seeds, you know, and that's when it starts, yeah, so that's a biennial. Well, a perennial is like a spruce tree, a birch tree, a cedar tree, you know, these are plants that you plant and they last for many, many years. You don't have to replant them. Strawberries are perennials, or cherry trees, and apples, and pears, rhubarb, you know, these flowers, they're perennials. So we're trying our best to have a perennial garden, so it's not really high maintenance. These are some elderberries. We do have natural elderberries that are here on the land, but we wanted more. We wanted to sell some berries to, there's a winery in town, and hopefully other people, we'll just see what happens. This is one of the apples I thought wasn't gonna make it. So it doesn't look that great, but still, I think it is gonna make it. Yarrow, that's my favorite plant. Achillea millifolium. Achilles got his nickname or his name from that plant because his mother, when he was a little baby, picked him up by the heel right here. It was like my favorite story. Picked him up by the heel and she dunked him into a bath with Achillea millifolium as like an essential oil in the bath. And it made him invincible. Everything besides that is supposed to be really good for your skin. Anytime we have infections, the dogs, me, anything. And we use it for compost tea. You know, we make a lot of compost tea here that we spread on the plant. So yeah, I love yarrow. Then we got comfrey. You know, that's another, it's what they call a biomass accumulator, being that it's a perennial plant that grows up nice and hardy, produces a lot of material that we can use in our compost, as well as it's a bee attractant. you'll see on nice days, you know, the bees seem to be pretty lazy today. Yeah, the bees will come in and they'll just get all over this stuff. And of course, daisies, because they're beautiful. So again, we got the apple, a pear tree, which people have been asking, do they grow pears in Alaska? And so far, I don't know of anyone growing pears in Alaska, even up at the University of Alaska Fairbanks. But you know, we're gonna try. We're gonna try. I mean, the way I see it, one of these pear trees, we have four. One of them was $25. $25, you know? I mean, that's, if you drink, which I don't anymore, $25, five beers, you know what I mean? I mean, I spent a lot of nights spending $25. So I see it as four $25 investments. If it doesn't really work out, well, that's all right. But if it does, I think, yeah, that'll be a wonderful thing. So they're Asian pears. That's what the guy told me. He thought they'd do better than the European. I'm really taking his advice. We got the elderberries again. So this is kind of like a, it's like a north, this is the north side of our property. So that's why we've planted the trees on this north side with intentions of them growing tall, kind of being a little bit of a windbreak from the wind that way, as well as a windbreak for that side from the wind this way. And then on the south side of our property over there, we have that row of trees. And in between them, we have rhubarb. And we're hoping that the apples will grow up there and not too tall so they don't provide shade, but enough to provide a little bit of a windbreak. You know, we're trying to really make this garden environment a nice, moist, wind-free as much as possible environment, you know, with behind it, the trees. So that's what we're going for. So then we've also scattered a bunch of seeds as cover crops. You know, a cover crop is what farmers use to protect their soil, to replenish the minerals and nutrients that they use each season. Before, you know, like the Dust Bowl time, people weren't using cover crops and things. Maybe they were, but not as much. They were just plowing and plowing and plowing and growing and growing and growing the same things. And then eventually that soil got depleted and it became so hard panned from tilling so much that those winds came and no roots, no plants were in the ground to hold the soil. You know, so just blew it away. So all this stuff that was either bare or this here's the horsetail again and there's grasses, you know, we've done our best to plant clover and, you know, it's coming up in patches, man. But as the years go by, I think it'll get thicker and thicker and thicker. And the clover is a nitrogen fixing plant. Yeah, there's all this nitrogen floating in the air and the plants can't get it. There's certain nitrogen fixing plants like the horsetail as well, that they have this little bacteria on their roots, these little nodules, and they're called rhizobium bacteria. They're pretty sweet. They store the energy of the nitrogen. And then when you come and you cut the clover down, all that nitrogen goes into the soil. So it keeps you from having to buy nitrogen fertilizers. So we don't buy any kind of like artificial fertilizers here, you know. Just want to say that we're doing our best to stay natural and organic. Another apple, you know, Gravenstein, that's my homie. I think it's probably the best one that's been going on so far. I read this article the other day from this guy. His name, I believe, is Michael Phillips. He wrote a book called The Organic Orchardist. He was like the guy for growing fruit, and he was saying that no matter what year your plants are when you put them in the ground, to expect to wait like 7 years for your apples to produce. He laughed and said, you know, it's not for impatient gardeners. We're trying to stay patient, you know. They're pretty small, but last year was their second year alive. This is their third year. And as time goes on, they're gonna get bigger and we can only cross our fingers and hope they produce some fruit for us, you know. So around here, similar things, you know, we got oak tree. We're trying, you know. Don't know if it's gonna work, but we're gonna try raspberry rhubarb. This is a butternut. So it's a different type of nut tree that man Michael told me would work really well here. Honest to God, I never seen a butternut. I don't know what it looks like, but I hope we get some, man. Yeah, more raspberries. So the hope, you know, of course, we plant these in hopes that the rhubarb grow big and then we can propagate them, divide them, and move them to other areas. So in the end, we can have tons of rhubarb and raspberries that we can sell as well as can. Oak tree. Another thing we're trying to do is not destroy all the natural landscape that's here. We're trying to work with the natural landscape, which is why we haven't just cleared all the trees and all the roots and everything. We're just trying to work around it, you know, saving us a lot of money, a lot of energy, and it's providing homes for all the birds and bugs and all the beautiful things that are here. Yep, we got another nut tree here, little McDonald. I envision it growing huge and taking this thing over, producing a bunch of hazelnuts. Another little rhubarb. Here's the worker we got helping us this year, Levi. He's a great young man. Couldn't ask for better help. He's working on our solar panel stand here. We got the solar panels for free from owners of this place called Orcas Island in Seward. Their son was redoing the yurts that they rent. Yeah, he gave them to us, you know, so we put them to use. We've had them just on the ground, kind of propped against this and propped against that, and they work, you know. We don't have a big battery system. It's just one right now. But just because we're starting and we don't like spending a bunch of money on stuff, we're waiting. People are always getting rid of these batteries, man. And they're expensive, so we're kind of being patient. The PVC stand, which Levi made, he's a plumber, cost $7, you know, because we had a bunch of scraps sitting around. He did buy this plywood, which was $71. All in all, I mean, for the solar panels, this charge controller, which we have, which tells you how much you're getting in, which right now we're not getting anything, but our charge is at 99%. We do need to, I told Levi too, we gotta orient them a little bit more south, but we will. But anyways, it's got a sweet little USB. You just come in here and you know, he's a smart guy. He's got three of them little phones, them little laptop things, and he's on them all the time, but he's found a way to hook them all up to one charge adapter, and he'll charge all three. You know, we charge all of our stuff with this, is what it comes down to. Our phones, our computers, anything that needs a charge, this is how we charge it. Inside here is where the plan is to put the battery bank. You know, it'll be waterproof and it'll be protected from the elements for the winter. Right now it's just that one little battery. Yeah, man, so that's the solar panel stand. Perhaps in the future, this land here, you know, I would really like to clear out some more. I mean, not all of it, of course, but this is nice flat land. And in order to make money on my property, which I do want to do because I don't want to work for other people my whole life, and I love to farm, but yeah, I'm gonna have to clear this out and then start using that for the agriculture as well. So we got more nut trees here, which we're crossing our fingers, just like the pears. People can laugh, and that's fine. Maybe sometime we'll get nuts. If we do, we'll be roasting a lot of nuts on a fire, let me tell you. We also got some redwood trees we bought this year, all from that same guy, you know. The name of this road here, I hate to give away my location, is Tall Tree. And it was all huge, tall forest trees until I think it was like 14 years ago. There was the spruce beetle that came through. Like now the aphids in Homer, the spruce beetle came through, wiped out a bunch of them. And then a fire came through, wiped out more, and then loggers came through. And they logged all the big, beautiful trees that were around here. And then after they got done logging it all, they piled the stumps into these big piles. And then they were selling the acreage for like dollars on the acre, so they didn't have to clean it up, you know? We ended up buying the land, the 20 acres and the house, for $80,000. It was money that I had saved from when I was in the military. When I was in Iraq, I was saving and saving with intentions of buying property in Alaska when I came home. You know, I grew up in apartments and little houses and never had a spot really, you know? So I always really wanted something for our family to be able to grow on and have future generations grow on. And this was the spot that we found, which pleased everyone who was involved in the deal with the house and the land. And yeah, so now, you know, it's 4 years later, that $80,000 loan, I put $16,000 down, brought our payment to $64,000 we were paying on. And that payment is $540 a month. And we put down extra, so at this point, we owe like $30,000. I think it's gonna be paid off in the next 3 years is the way I plan to have it done. And then we'll be interest-free, no debt, living with the solar, off the grid. I mean, you'll see, we heat with wood. You know, I mean, everything we do, man, we try to do frugally, but also understanding Maslow's hierarchy of needs. We don't wanna get stuck in the surviving phase where we're not creative at all. We want time so we can be creative, we can play music and write and my girlfriend record music and all kinds of stuff. So, and maybe at some point have some children and be able to, you know, have a family or something. This is our compost right now. Sorry, it looks a little kind of corn husky, but. So this is all grass that we cut yesterday and the day before, mowing everything. And a lot of it's got clover and grasses and vetch and things. And this is part of a compost that we had last year from chicken manure and all kinds of stuff that we've just been adding and adding and adding stuff to. So what we're gonna end up doing is mixing this with this. And then once we get it all nice and mixed, I mean, we're gonna make a nice mix of it. We're gonna cover it with straw for the winter. And then we're gonna use Rudolf Steiner's biodynamic preparations. I'm into biodynamics and Rudolf Steiner is amazing. So we're gonna use his preparations that we purchased from the Josephine Porter Institute in Virginia. And we're gonna inoculate our compost with the preparations and we'll let it sit for the winter and then we'll uncover it in the springtime. And that's what we'll use. We'll sift it out, filter what we need. Thankfully for my education, my college education, which was paid for by the military, I wouldn't have went if it wasn't for that. I did learn a little bit about composting. I do understand the carbon and nitrogen ratio a little bit. Nothing here is scientific, but we are doing our best to layer. You know, you got your carbon, which is like your brown material, you know, and that takes longer to break down. And then you got your nitrogen, which is like your manure, your grasses, your green material. And it's finding that good layering system, you know? So usually when people build a compost, they'll start with like one layer of green, maybe a couple inches, and then boom, put in the brown, couple inches, then boom, put in the green, couple inches. And they're doing it like a cake or like a lasagna, but like a veggie, nasty lasagna. Yeah, so it all gets put in there, man. And that's, we're gonna add to it, of course, after we harvest all the green stuff. This is what we use for our composting that we will spread on everything next year, as well as the composting that we do in the beds, you know, with the cover crop and the clover and those things. I guess that's it about the compost for now. So as you see here, there's little clover, you know, that's taken up again. This was all really hard packed, you know, and we're crossing our fingers, hoping we can get a nice clover zone at some point. The fireweeds, beautiful background for us. Here we got apple trees, the Wolf River, and then the apples go around that way. We got some rhubarb, you know, that we propagated. A couple haven't made it, but you see here, this is one little guy. So you got the rhubarb plant. It's a big plant. It's got all these roots. Well, if you kind of look a little closer, which I'll show you with the rhubarb, I suppose, there's all these little crowns. And what you do is you take your little pruners and you cut those crowns and then you bring a crown and you plant it. And then you bring a crown and you plant it. And that one rhubarb plant, all of my rhubarb plants, which now last year was 12 after propagating and stuff, probably got like 30. Came from one plant that a guy gave me. And he gave me that one plant, and I took that one plant and I made all these cuts, you know? And then I broke my ankle skateboarding. So I used this person's yard in Seward for that summer, and I put all the raspberries that people gave me, and I put all the rhubarb into this garden in Seward. And everybody's like, oh, you're so nice, Bob, beautifying the area. And I'm like, yeah, I am. But I knew I was gonna take them and I was gonna bring them here, you know what I mean? So that's what happened, man. I brought them out here and that one plant became like 30 and just trying to get more and more so we can, you know, make a few dollars on it and have a bunch for food and wine and whatever else people want. We're gonna go up here to the house here in a second. One thing I did forget to mention about the garden area is that we do not have a tiller. We don't have a tractor. What we do have are hand tools and some really strong, lean bodies. So we did all this stuff by hand, you know, which ain't that big a deal to a lot of people, but we got this awesome tool from a thrift store in Homer that was built by this guy, this woman's grandfather. She used it in Homer for a lot of years, or he did actually. And then he was retiring from farming, so he lent it to, well, he gave it to us. That's what we've used to build our beds and to hoe and pretty much till the land. So yeah, now we'll go forward. We just got this four-wheeler this year, which has been used so far as a really great entertainment source or source of entertainment. I guess I haven't quite used it yet for a tool. Right now there's some cedars in this tarp that I was gonna bring to the other property, on the other side of the property. After I planted the cedars, I read that article by that fella. He had mentioned how he learned the hard way. He lost his first 55 apple trees to cedar apple borers. He said he got a degree in borers because all of his apple trees got eaten by a bug that transmits from the cedar to the apple. So I had some discussions with the gal and with Levi, of course, you know, and yeah, we decided we weren't going to risk it. We were just going to dig them cedars up. They're still super young, and we're going to bring them to the other side of the property so we don't risk any infestations. Yeah. This is my sweet little economical car that gets like 30, 40, I don't even know. It seems like forever miles to the gallon. Inherited it from my mama. She just passed away here last October. This is the work truck we use for all kinds of stuff, whether it's going kayaking or getting wood or whatever it is, man. It's the truck. This was, I don't mean to be a junkyard, but this is an old Volkswagen this guy gave me. He gave it to me and I was just thrilled. I was like, oh yeah, yeah, let's do this. I want to be a Volkswagen over. And I was driving it home and everybody was flying by me, you know. And I learned probably after like the 10th time of driving it that I don't really like driving really slow. And I didn't really like being the slowest guy out there and always worrying about it breaking down. So I parked it and used it for storage for one winter. And then it kind of became the storage unit. And yeah, the neighbor wants to trade me. He's got a little wood mill. We're gonna be doing some trading here in the next little bit. He wants to give me some lumber and he wants the van for his daughter, I guess. And I'm just kind of waiting for him to come and get it, you know what I mean? So here's the other part, you know, we're getting to the house and the yard and everything. When we first got this place, there was the house. It was roughed in, there was no heat. The well, we had well and septic. The well was direct laid PVC pipe that was not withstandable to winters here in Alaska. First thing we had to do is dig a trench that goes from the well, which is like 123 feet to the house at 4 to 5 feet. We got that dug, got new piping, not PVC, this beautiful PEX. Got that installed, pitless adapter. And then that goes from the well to the house where it goes up into a 65 gallon storage tank that warms with the wood heat and then is gravity fed. You know, we pump the well, we get all of our water, and then it's all gravity fed. In this summer, where we've been watering all of these plants and things, we've probably used, I would say, a maximum of 3 gallons of fuel for all of our water. You know, it's really efficient. It's a 5700 McCulloch generator that we got with the house. And we also run a 1000-watt Mitsubishi when we wanna watch movies and things. That Mitsubishi, when my girlfriend, she recorded an album here. She was recording from like literally 9 in the morning till 11 at night. And that Mitsubishi, which is like 1.2 gallon tank, would run, boom, from morning till night, man. I mean, the thing is so efficient. I mean, people come over all the time, you know, and no offense to any of them, but they come over when I didn't have the panels and be like, when are you gonna get panels? What about all the wind out here? You need a wind generator. And I'm like, dude, I spend like maybe $2 to $4 a week on my energy bills before the solar panels. Like I use wood heat, like, but you can't really explain that to people, you know? They don't wanna listen. They're like, oh, whatever, just get, and it's like, all right, well, I don't really wanna spend the $900 for this stuff or whatever, you know, so. But hopefully at some point, you know, we would love to not have to run the generator for the well. And but in the meantime, it's great. You know, I just had my cousin and her family come out and stay. They're from Anchorage. They're really wealthy people, man. Great family, 2 beautiful houses, triplexes, mortgages, probably $750,000 for both, you know. They make one $80,000, the other probably $100,000. You know, make a lot of money, man. And they came out here and, you know, the very first thing, they drove their RV here from Anchorage. You know, they were in the RV, you know. They'd be like, oh, you want to come hang out? Come to the RV. And I'm like, you guys can come inside my house, you know, but it's just a little different than the way they live, you know. I was thankful they came, but very first morning I woke up, and I came out, it was sunny, and I stretched, and I was like, oh, you guys, it feels good. And they're like, what? What feels good? And I was like, you know, I'm not trying to brag. I tell everybody who stays here this, and they're like, what? I was like, well, I didn't spend any money last night while I slept, you know, not a single dollar. I mean, people who live on the grid, I mean, unless you have some way to turn it off, which most people don't, you know, you're spending money as you sleep. And I think that's really problematic when it comes to having to work so much just to pay your bills. So we love the off the grid. Turn it off, turn it on when you want it, man. And that's it. This here's a rhubarb. Yeah, the rhubarb beds, you know, same thing. They're only a couple years old. We've harvested them strong this year because Miguel makes an amazing cream pie. Yeah, the rhubarb's doing pretty good. Pretty good. These are our chives, you know, there ain't much of them right now. Little purple ones there too, but we've harvested them and stored some as well as sold some. These are our little strawberries. Same type of thing. They were eaten down last year by the chickens, as well as the raspberries and the rhubarb, and now they're coming back. So we think that as future goes on, you know, it'll just get better and better. We got little strawberries forming now. Obviously, it takes some time weeding. You know, it's not always like this. All this horsetail grows and grows and grows. We got peas planted, interspersed. Because they are nitrogen fixers, they do bring nitrogen to the soil. We can also eat them as we go, but on the outside here, we got peas growing up the Sainer's net, which you can get in abundance for a good price, being that we live next to a fishing community. So a Sainer, it's a fishing boat that uses a small skiff, and that skiff goes out with one end of the net. And you know, they sometimes got helicopters up above. If not, they got the captain looking out and they see the schools of fish. Well, the one guy gets on that skiff and he motorboats with the one side of the net and he goes around the school of fish. And then they hook that up to this crane type system that's in the back of their boat and boom, they pull the schools out with the Sainer's net. There's always a bunch of Sainer's net around. Yeah, raspberries, you know, little guys are starting to form. We got an abundance of bees. Wish we had more for you guys to see, but it's rainy. We got these strawberries. I'm tempted to eat. Oh, I would love to do honey. I really would, man. Yeah, and it's just, it's that same thing, one thing at a time. After we lost our chickens, and we were all gung-ho about the chickens. I love the chickens, man. And then to know that most of them died, I just really don't want to jump into any more animals until I know that me and Miguel want to be here for the winters. It's going to be a permanent thing, or we have a cabin built where someone can stay, because I just don't want to bring any more animals on that have to die, you know? And I know it is hard for people up here in Alaska with storing bees for the winter, because they a lot of times don't have enough honey and it's too cold. Yeah, I would love to do bees, man. Just like I want to tap these birch trees, you know? But it's just one thing at a time. And with just me out here, it was really rough this year. I've had help from Levi, but still there's only so much we can do in the future, you know? Yeah, this is our yard. This understand the skirting, which I think is interesting. When I went traveling in Mexico, I met this guy, a Belgian, who had bought this property in Puerto Escondido. He was building, he built this beautiful like 4-story tall building, palapa style roof. I mean, the guy knew what he was talking about. He said that the first couple years he was building there, he had spent hundreds, thousands of euro on varnish to treat all of his wood. And he said the Mexicans were always laughing. He was like, I don't understand, you know, why they keep laughing at me. I keep going to Belgium and I come back and I go and back. They keep laughing. He said that one of them finally told him why they're laughing. And they're laughing because all the locals would use used motor oil. And they'd use it just like they would varnish. And they'd apply it and let it sit in the sun. And it soaks up the oil, the used motor oil. And it's free, you know? I mean, people just dump motor oil all over the place. We were questioning whether or not to do it here in Alaska. It's a little bit different than Mexico. So far, I mean, we haven't had problems. We're not using it next to the garden, you know what I mean? And letting it dry, and yeah, I use it on all my stuff, man, straight up. I use it on all my varnishing. This is our young orchard, you know? This is the first year we put most of these trees in. The ones on the far end down there, it's their second year. They were our experimentals. And since they made it and they look good, we decided to go with the more. We got 40 more apple trees this year to go with the 12 from last year. Yeah, there's just a whole bunch of different varieties, you know? Gravenstein, Battleford, Parkland, Spartan, Red Harrelson, like I said, Honeycrisp. I mean, the list goes on. There's multiple varieties, and we're trying to learn, you know, from the potato famine in Ireland that we don't want to plant all the same variety, man. We don't want a pest that loves one variety of plant to come through and wipe us out. So we're doing our best to plant different varieties, see which ones produce the best here in Alaska in our environment. And then in the future, we will invest more of our time, money, and energy into those trees. But in the meantime, you know, right now it's this experimental thing. We still have some trees in the area, in the orchard. You know, we're torn whether to cut them or keep them. I wrote an article once for the newspaper that was to cut or to keep, because I cut down a big birch tree that blocked our view of a volcano, Mount Redoubt. Yeah, my girl was happy. She could see the volcano from the kitchen, you know. But we're still in that same situation, you know, all the time wondering what we should cut, what we should keep. And if it ends up that these trees are having problems, or, which I don't think they're going to, man. I think it's gonna be just fine. This birch tree, you know, it could go down, we could get some more sunlight. The way it is, these trees get so much sun, and it is north facing, you know? So if it were southern facing, you'd get the sun that just goes boom. But since it's north facing, it refracts off of the Earth's surface, so it doesn't get as warm and as much direct energy as if it were a south facing slope. Like our veggie garden is slightly south, and that's why I really do suspect that our trees that are up there are gonna do better, because it's just, there's that southern slope, man. But still, we're doing it, you know, we're trying it out. Over here, we got this, what I like to call the cook henlet. It's our chicken coop. So my girlfriend last year was like, hey Robert, you know, this is before I went to a carpentry avtech class, which I still don't know what I'm doing. Anyways, my girl was like, hey, this girl's giving us chickens, we need a coop by tomorrow. I was like, oh God. All right, I didn't know what to build. And we had all this scrap material under our deck that we used to build the house. And it had been sitting there for like 2 years. So I just pieced something together, and it worked, man. It worked really great. We had the chickens in here for one winter. We didn't have a heat light. We would have a heat light again if we did it again, because they were getting a little bit of damage up here on their crowns, as well as a little bit on their goblets or gobblers. And they were getting a little frostbite damage, but we took a woman's advice who owned Wagon Wheel and Homer, who said that all you need to do is just put a thick layer of straw down, let them poop. Thick layer of straw on top of sawdust. Thick layer of straw, let them poop. Thick, and you keep doing that, and all through the winter, I mean, by the time we took all the straw in the springtime, none of our birds had died. Man, we had like a thick cake of like the best compostable manure and straw combination, which we used in the gardens. But yeah, if next time we get chickens, we do want to get a little light, you know. We will have a little battery for them on them really cold winter nights. But what I am most fond of is this little thing. You know, I'm not a builder, I'm a finder. And I found this when I was cutting wood, and that was like the easiest door latch ever, man. But yeah, so that's the cook henlet. This is our septic leach field area, so we're not planting any food on here. It's just clover, you know, which you can see has been coming up. So, you know, like I said before, this is all hard packed, man. Especially this, because the guy had just brought in machinery, done all the work. And so, yeah, I mean, we didn't do most of this. This is Mother Earth coming back and being like, give me that. But we have planted some clovers and things. Yeah, this is kind of our border, you know, for our first little go-ahead. This is what we're going to work with. We're going to try our best to maintain all these plants and trees. And then as time goes on, yeah, we'll clear out some more land and do more planting. And hopefully they all produce. And we can, I don't know, not only store food, but sell a little bit to make some money. So here we are, Anchor Point, Alaska. We got Nala and Charger and our rain barrel, which is working as we speak. We just put it up the other day, this gutter. And man, you'd be surprised how quick that thing fills up. It's actually becoming a problem that it overflows so much. Yeah, but here in time, we're gonna do all of it, you know. So far, we just got this side and the other side that are done. And then, man, what a difference it makes to be able to walk from here to there and be collecting. And, you know, obviously, it's pretty big deal. So, yeah, we use this water for watering all of our plants. We water the plants with this water. When we don't have, or if, like, we just run the well, I mean, that water comes out of the well, it's cold, man. The plants don't like that. So a lot of times we do the rainwater, and when we water with this, we fill these two, you know? Before we got this all set up, it was probably like a week ago, we finally got it set up where we can water everything from the well water that's stored up there. But before that, and even now, we just collect the water, we fill these up, and we hand water. Or we'll use them, you know, I'll boil it up and use it to do dishes, sometimes not boil it.
Most of the time, not boil it. I do my dishes.
Yeah, but I generally use it for watering plants. You know, our neighbor lived in a house for a lot of years, 20 plus years. It wasn't really well insulated. No skirting, no insulation in the floor, the walls, you know. And he would go through about 11 cords of wood in a winter. So one cord is 4 feet by 4 feet by 8 feet. So he'd go through 11 cords in a winter. Us, we lived here so far one complete winter. And I think we probably went through about three. I mean, like right now, I built a fire in there this morning, you know, and that's the only fire I have, and it'll heat up the house and then it stays warm throughout the day. Yeah, so in the summer we hardly burn, you know, and in the winter we burn more, but you know, it's abundant out here, the birch as well as the spruce, and we definitely do our best to harvest just dead ones, you know. And yeah, we found that this wall here works really good for us for the winter time. A lot of winds come from the north, and just parking at the vehicle moving this way, you know, you get blasted, and the wall really helps keep our path a little less icy, less nasty. One thing I really learned about firewood, a lot of things. I wasn't like Mr. Lumberjack, nor am I still, you know what I mean? Like I said, I was raised and lived in apartments and houses, just been learning as I go. But you know, this wood that we just stacked outside here in this row, not underneath anything, not beside the house, not covered by a tarp, it cured or seasoned just fine. Like we can burn all this stuff. You know, there's some that's rotten, you know, but we got some other stuff that's perfectly seasoned and it's outside exposed to the elements. So that was a big thing for us. Like, cause we kept being like, oh, we needed to build a woodshed. So we put up this little shanty lean-to. Oh, we need, and you know, it was nice, you know, got a little dry space or whatever, but I really do like this style, like the walls. Yeah. I think it looks cool, man. So that's kind of, yeah, that's kind of it with that. We'll come inside. Nala, her tongue never goes inside of her mouth because it's too big. She's the princess or queen around here. And here's our little shed, and that has our generator, our tools. We got little wood for inside. My brother made this. You know, it's not the most amazing piece of furniture in the world, but my God, we're not gonna throw it away. Normally we take off our shoes when we enter, but we're gonna make an exception this time. So now we are in the immaculate kitchen of our cabin here. Nothing spectacular, but you know, we got what we need and some. The oven wasn't here when we bought it. We brought the oven in, got some basic shelving, you know what I mean? Nothing spectacular. Don't mind the diet and the Whoppers. This was here, you know, the guy had made this sink cover or the countertop. It's beautiful, you know what I mean? But this happened this year. It's not the most pressure in the world, but hey, it works. And then we can filter it, you know? We got a filter that hooks up to the well, goes through the filter, goes into the tank upstairs, which you'll see, and then we filter it through here. So we do filter it twice before we drink it. Haven't had it tested yet, but it passes the taste test with flying colors. The guy who built this house, his name is Wayne Sapp. He was from Iowa. Him and his wife bought this land and built the house. They were gonna use it as a summer retreat, but then they had, before he finished the house, they had a big tornado storm that blew down their biggest barn in Iowa, and they needed money. So they ended up turning around and selling the place, and that's why we got it for such a good deal. But now I'm really glad. At first I saw it as like kind of a, gosh, I got this house, I don't know what to do, my Lord. But now I'm thankful because we've been able to do a lot more work outside, and I couldn't build something like this, you know, I just couldn't, not yet in my life, you know. Like I stated before, there are unfinished projects. You'll see, we put the wood stove in, it works amazing. It's an earth stove, it's not cast iron, it's steel. And yeah, that's our money maker right there. It really heats up. We heat up our water on it. A lot of times we got cast iron skillets we put on there, so we'll heat water and cook. Got this sweet little fan that spins as it heats, and that spins or pushes some air around. Got my unfinished mosaic, which is just gorgeous. I know, my God, everybody wants to buy one of these. Got a nice little hide bed here, little corner area where we hang out when it's clear. Like right now you can see a little bit, but looking to the west, there's Mount Redoubt, which is a volcano. And yeah, our northern view of Sturiski Valley. You'll see a lot of moose down there, hear wolves, coyotes at night. Doesn't take too much to heat, pretty small. All right, so our bathroom here, like I said, is unfinished because I'm not really that great of a carpenter. Now we have a toilet that runs, which
I don't care about, but my girlfriend cares about, and I can understand why. It's nice when people come over to be able to send them to the toilet instead of the outhouse. Not to get private, but I pee all around the outside of our land. You know, not the 20 acres, but where we have the orchard. And that acts, I think, as like a border for the animals to stay away. We mark our territory. And I talk to my dogs, like they're little humans. And I'm like, go pee on the borders. And I swear they do, man. So yeah, now we got a toilet, which is nice. But we would like to put a bath. Not sure if dimensions match up. We do have it plumbed for water, both hot water on demand system, as well as the cold water. So once I figure out a design that I want in here, which I'm having trouble with, we'll get it done, you know? But in the meantime, we go to Anchor Point. It's 8 miles away. And, you know, going to town to check the mail or whatever. And there's a nice laundromat, shower place. Pay $5, 11 minutes of hot shower. I mean, you know, I'm a infantryman myself, so I take like a 2-minute shower. A lot of times I don't take the whole shower. I'm like, all right, you know. So sometimes, same thing as with the generator, like, do I need to do it? Do I need to make a shower in here? You know, but I know it would be nice at some point, especially if we want to rent it or just to have it finished. But so this is the bathroom. It's pretty basic right now. And then we have a back room back here that we just put some flooring down for. And that's generally used for, like, right now our worker. He stays in that back room. And we've had people visit. They stay in the back room. But, yeah, that's just kind of storage right now. So walking up the stairs to my loft, which is actually a sauna when we have it heated up in here. It's a beautiful thing and a bad thing, you know, having a loft like this. We don't have an overhead fan, which we would really like to get, or some other fan up here. But when it's cold outside and you have the heat blazing up here, I mean, you're sleeping desnudo, yeah. Which is Spanish for without clothes. Like, you can't be in clothes. It's so hot, man. Hot. We did have a house sitter stay here at one point, and she was really into, what's that, hot yoga, Bikram? Yeah. And she was like, this is the best yoga studio ever, you know? And she loved it, but same type of thing. Floor's unfinished, you know? We got some carpet tiles, thinking about laying down, but then I'm like, oh, why should I? I got other things I want to do, but pretty simple, you know? Got our bed, our little table area, a rocking chair, you know, a friend gave us, our little hot water heater. Earlier, I made a mistake, because usually I have Levi, who's the plumber, fill up the water tank. You know, we run the well, fill up the water. Well, I was the one in charge, and of course, I'm Mr. Multitask, so I was building a fire at the same time, and it overflowed, you know? So we ended up having a little bit of water that went on the ground here underneath it, and I'm cleaning it up, so sorry for the mess. But it's our little closet space, you know? It ain't nothing spectacular, man, but it's easy, it's simple, you know? I don't spend a lot of time looking at what I'm gonna wear in the morning. I generally just put it on and go forth with my day. So yeah, I mean, it's nice up here, man. You know, you can sit in the rocking chair and look out to the north, and if it's winter, I mean, literally you can lay in bed and you can see the northern lights. I mean, my girlfriend's first winter was here in Alaska, her first winter. And on her birthday, October 1st of that year, I remember I woke, for some reason I had to wake up and go to the restroom, and I went outside on the deck and I looked up and they were just all over the sky. I was like, oh my God. I came upstairs like, Sunrisa, you gotta go, check it out. She's like, what? And she gets out there and literally just cries. She's just crying. Oh my God, yeah. She was up for like 45 minutes, you know, like you can walk probably longer. Me, I've seen it so much, you know, I grew up in Nome, but seen it so much, just like, oh yeah, the northern lights, it's great, you know? But it is really nice to be able to be in your own home, look out the windows, go on your deck. There's no light pollution, which is another huge quality in off-the-grid living. No light pollution. I see the stars. I see, you know, I wouldn't say Uranus, but I see some things out there, you know? And yeah, man, so it's nice. Yeah, this is the spot.
So if somebody is watching this and they're considering doing the off-the-grid living, it's something that they're kind of hesitant about, but it's something they really want to do, what advice would you give them?
The advice I would give them would be to make a priority list. First and foremost, if you want an off-the-grid life, to prioritize your projects, to not think, okay, I'm going to get my water done, get my electric done, get my house built, get my farm built, get all this stuff done. You're going to spread yourself too thin, you know? So prioritizing is the biggest thing. The first couple years, I really didn't have a priority list. I was trying to work the other 10 acres and this, and next thing you know, as you see, you know, I got unfinished stuff and it really should be done. So the priority list making would be one. Number two, reading the magazines, Mother Earth News, these videos and stuff. But really not taking them so seriously. The thing with the Mother Earth News, I love the magazines. I love all the online stuff, but a lot of times, you know, you see this house and it's beautiful, or you see this copper run system from a wood stove that heats up your water in your house and all this stuff. And they really don't tell you how much all this stuff costs to get that beautiful off the grid life, you know? So I would say that if you want to move off the grid, it's kind of like quitting drinking. You need to ease into it, you know? Otherwise you're going to be like a couple of my neighbors who live out here, who are miserable, who have three generators that they run 24/7 because they miss constant power. They haven't found a way to find comfort in their life going to sleep without a TV. So I would say, you know, like weaning yourself off of the energy use, because we're such slaves to it, man. So that would be my other big one. And then the last one would definitely be to not be so extreme about it, you know, to go off little by little, like you're weaning off. When I first bought this place and I just got done going to college at Evergreen for sustainable agriculture, I was out here and I was like, oh my God, I want to leave no footprint, leave no footprint. So literally I would turn my generator on and I would run, you know, I would water stuff and I'd run. I was trying to do I was turning something that was really fun into something that was really hard. You know, it's taking away all the fun of it, you know. I've got other people, my neighbors, you know, I mean, they know that if their volume on their TV is at 23, it will use this much more wattage than if it's at 21. You know, like you can go as far as you want, but to me, I want to live and I want to be happy, and I don't want to be a stingy, mean person, you know, who's constantly pinching everything. I really want to enjoy it, but use less and less. So that would be my advice.
What was your biggest surprise in doing this? Because it sounds like if you went to college for it, it was definitely predetermined in your mind you wanted to do this. But what was the biggest surprise when you actually got here and you were doing it? Like something that you didn't expect, either good or bad.
Well, to get personal again, the biggest surprise I would definitely say was, I bought this with my brother and with his gal at the time. We all went in together. This was going to be a joint effort. And that only lasted for a short time before they didn't want in anymore. And then it was like, oh, well, just sell us 1 acre. Or first it was, let's deduct the house from what we're paying because we don't live in the house. So you pay for the house and we'll just pay on the land. Well, you know, we bought the house because you guys wanted a house. So it created turmoil in my family, in me. For a couple years there, this was a grudge. This was a weight on my shoulders that I didn't want to carry, this house. Felt like it was just rotting. And then, you know, I've had other family who said they were going to come out with a dozer or equipment or just their kids, and they were going to come and help. And I just can't tell you how many people have said, we're going to come out there, we're going to help. We want to help. We want to help. And, you know, by no means have I done this on my own. I mean, I have had a lot of help, but there have been projects that I put on hold that should have been done, but I was waiting for that excavator, you know? So it was learning, you know, a lot about your friends and your family and who you can ask for help, you know? And that was really the greatest obstacle I've found. You know, I learned a lot about doing relations and business with family, you know, and that was the hardest obstacle, which I feel like we've gotten over pretty well now,
right?
Being that it's all mine.
So last last question. Somebody that's on the fence. This is something, I mean, it kind of looks like you're enjoying this thoroughly.
Yeah.
So somebody that's on the fence, they're getting ready to pull the trigger. They work the five days a week behind a cubicle, and they're really wanting to get out. And you did talk about earlier, you know, taking it easy, easing into it.
Mm-hmm.
But if somebody was on the fence, what motivation would you give them? Like, what would you tell somebody that is getting ready to do something like this, other than ease into it? Or do you feel as though this is necessarily something most people would aspire to, because some people are, you know, said they're addicted to a certain type of lifestyle.
Yeah.
Maybe they might not enjoy it out here. But theoretical situation, somebody that would really love it, they've been putting it on hold, they've been, you know, procrastinating, actually pulling the trigger. What advice, what motivation would you give them?
Well, you know, that's a really great question. So I once bought a boat, and I worked really hard on varnishing all the trim of the sailboat, you know, and I didn't know anything about sailing. I didn't know anything about running boats. I bought it for $500. I thought I was getting a deal, you know, and ended up just working, sanding, and doing all this stuff that really didn't affect the way the boat ran. It didn't teach me how to run a boat or sail. And in the end, that boat, I sailed it twice before the engine went out on it, trying to bring it back into the harbor. I learned the hard way. But yeah, that boat, it finally ended up costing me about $2,500 in mooring fees. You know, it was back due from the guy I bought it from. And at that point, I was reading this book. It was called Rich Dad, Poor Dad, Teaching the Rich and Middle Class. Teaching the poor and middle class what the rich already know. And it was talking about the importance of dropping your assets or your liabilities, I mean. It was talking about how hard it is at times when you got something and you think it's a good investment, you know. Whether it's a new washer, whether it's a house, whatever it is, it's your car, you know. You think it's a good investment. It's going to make you money. It's going to pay off in the long run, you know. And really a lot of times it doesn't, and it's hard to drop them. You know, and that was one of those instances where I was like, gosh, but I want to keep this boat. But they're like, oh, you owe $2,500. Oh, and now you got $1,200 more on top of that for the year. And then there's all the maintenance and the engine. And next thing I know, I was looking at multiple thousands on something I thought was going to be a $500 adventure. So what did I do? I dropped the boat. You know what I mean? And I think that's a big thing when people are either super far in debt, or, you know, whether it's college debt, mortgage, cars, all these things that we go in debt for. I think if people are really miserable in their lives, I think that people need to learn how to give up some of those things. Take the hit to the pride. Feel embarrassed sometimes. Walk around, you know. Avoid yourself at the restaurant for 2 years. Whatever you got to do, you know. But I think that's a big deal, is learning how to drop what is bringing you down. You know, whether it's weeds in the garden or friends that are drug addicts and angry, you know what I mean? Like, learning how to get rid of all that stuff and flourish, man. At least trying to flourish, you know? And then learning a little bit along the way, you know? And then eventually doing it and going for it and not turning back. And, you know, the very first night I came here, my brother and I, we got here. Next morning, woke up. What happened? I left the car battery on. The truck was dead, you know? Very first day, I'm like, oh, great start, off the grid living, you know? Got to put a sign out for someone to start us, you know? And this guy pulls up. He's a neighbor. He pulls up on his four-wheeler. You know, he's got this awesome horse rider's jacket and long ponytail. And he gets off his four-wheeler. And literally the first thing he says to me and my brother, he says, I hope you guys have a notepad and a paper, because I got a lot to teach you guys here. And we're both like, hold up, man, what? You know, like, we couldn't believe that he told us that. And he repeated himself, hey, I got a lot to teach you guys here, you know, like, you make sure to write this down. And I don't know if it's our age, if it's my age, I don't know what it is, but every neighbor tells me what to do. Every person I meet, you know, everybody's telling me what to do. And there's times you take it, you know, and it's great advice. You really listen to it because they're wise. You learn from their mistakes, you know, but other times it's just like, will you please quit telling me what to do? You know, I bought this for me to pursue my dreams, not you to live vicariously through me or see my heartaches or whatever it is, you know? So yeah, I'd say motivation is just quit being scared, man. You know, it's just like anything else, I think, in the world. We're all afraid to make changes and just bucking up, making the change, being uncomfortable, getting over that learning curve, just like living in an RV, you know, get over the learning curve. And then eventually, like now it's 4 years. It's easy now. The first 2-3 years, I was stressing, man. Oh, God, how do, is it the house going to fall down? You know, it's all good, you know. And like I said, it's making things that are really fun, which is life and stewardship and farming and pursuing your dreams and making it so it's not fun, you know?
Yeah.
So that would be my, I guess, motivational factors.
Thank you, sir. Appreciate it.
Thank you.